aspect, but having a look at this just by the times at the bottom of the screen, we're talking 40 to 50 seconds behind Ben Jewell. That's how Jan Mulder is doing. At least 50 seconds. At least 50 seconds. So not a very good race for Jan Mulbeck, to be completely honest. Here's race leader Henrik Hoyer. 15 seconds remaining. It's going to be very close, but the time will run out before he reaches the finish line. That's the time gone. That's 4 seconds left. And there he is. That's your race winner, Henrik Hoyer, 2 hours of Pang, with 63 laps. Here comes Nikolaj Pedersen, he's in second position. And of course everybody crossing the line now will be finishing their race. Here we have Nikolaj Pedersen and Peter Munkholm going for the finish line. There comes Nikolaj Pedersen with 63 laps as well. Peter Munkholm is done. Chris Dons and Kasper Hougaard are still going for the finish. And Gert Nielsen in front of them. He's also going for the finish line. I think it's going to be Chris Dons who wins this one. Chris Dons, Kasper Hougaard just behind him. Peter Munkholm's already done. Gert Nielsen's done. Ben Jewell comes. Yeah, Ben Jewell's coming. I don't know whether or not he's actually done already. Jan Mulbeck's done. Ben Jewell might be done actually. Yeah. So that's it. The car's heading for the pit lane. That's the race over. Race winner is Henrik Hoyer with Nikolaj Pedersen on second position, 50 seconds behind dead actually. Then Chris Dons is on first position in GT1, Kasper Hougaard second position, Peter Munkholm is shuffling back to the pit, Gert Nielsen is on fourth position. It's nicely done of him. Ben Jewell is on fifth position. And then there's the same race TV car. And of course Jan Mulbeck and Steensteiniger. Both of them will probably be in the points. So that's the 2 hours of Sepang. What we'll do now is we'll have a quick chat with some of the drivers and see how they see how they're behaving. I'll just turn on the sound here, so prepare yourselves.
Han er som en forfarlig her på banen. Han har kostet mig placeringer i de sidste, hvad er det ikke, 4 løb, hvor jeg har kørt rundt med skadede biler og sådan på grund af ham.
Var han ved at bakke tilbage og ville køre ind i pitten der?
Ja.
Okay.
Det bidrager altså med lidt vending, kan man sige.
Lol.
Jamen tak for godt løb. Vi ses. Hej.
Ja, tak for godt løb.
Well.
Hej.
So, I think we're all set up. Well,
yeah.
The last thing we have to do is just have a quick talk with everybody here. And of course, the first guy I want to talk to is Henrik Høyer. Henrik Høyer, another first position for you, of course, but seemed like a much more interesting race this time around. And even though you were only two cars competing in MP1 again, a very, very interesting qualifying session, actually, and much closer in the race than we've used to see. So, how did the race seem from a driver's point of view?
It was a lot closer, and I was a lot more under pressure this time. With Nikolaj Pedersen in pole position, I couldn't just spear up from the start. I only managed to get a gap of 18 seconds or so before the first pit stops. The thing you can wonder is whether Nikolaj he did get a fast second stop. I don't know whether he had just fueled tighter than I have, because I haven't pre calculated how much fuel I was going to use. So I don't know if he did that, or if he double-stinted his tyres. I do suspect the last one double-stinted tyres, because he did lose a lot of time during the second stint. But it was a lot closer this time.
And certainly a much more interesting effort in the LMP1 race. Moving down to the second position in LMP1, that is of course you, Nikolaj Pedersen. And Nikolaj, you do have some explaining to do, meaning that suddenly somewhere in the race after the second round of pit stops, you and Henrik Høyer were only 7 or 8 seconds apart, actually, and I'd like to know what happened there, because actually all of a sudden you were very close together.
Yeah, I did hope that I could overtake him by double stinting my tires to the end, but it didn't happen, unfortunately. And I hit Ben Juul going into the last chicane, the last corner. So my splitter went wrong somehow. So that's why I lost so much time at the end, because my tires were good. I double stinted them for the two last stints, and they were just fine.
Okay, so that's what happened. We saw you at some point being 7 or 8 seconds apart, and I think you ended up being actually 50 seconds dead behind Henrik Høyer.
Yeah, for the last 20 minutes, I was just struggling to hold my car on the road, because It was a mess in front. I don't know why we hit each other, but we'll see what Ben Juul has to say later on.
All right. Another thing. A short word on the qualifying session for the LMP1 cars. It seemed you were tagging each other quite a lot, shifting positions all along, and it seemed to be interesting conditions, because even though there was quite a lot of spray in the beginning, you were all on dry tires, as far as I know, and you went a lot quicker in the end of the session. So a few words on the qualifying session as well, please.
Yeah, at the beginning it was raining. It was not very good to drive, So I did some laps and on soft intermediates, and I thought that I should try the soft slicks. So I just did the soft slicks front and back, and it turned out it was the best combo.
All right. Well, moving down a class to GT1. We find Chris Stons in the win this time around, and Chris, pretty much the opposite of what happened last time at Suzuka, given that the lead swapped just at the end of the race, as it did last time, but this time in your favor.
Yeah, and it was the opposite in many ways, because last time I was in pole position, this time I was second, and last time I had the fastest lap, this time it was Casper. So everything was the other way around, and yeah, that also means a victory for me, so that's great.
And as usual, you two guys are very close in the race, and your cars seem to be achieving very similar performance. Also, as usual, we see Casper pitting in two or three laps before you, and then we see you pitting in just behind him, and pretty much doing the same pit strategy, just set off by a few laps.
Yeah, I think it used to be the opposite way around. I think Casper used to go a little longer on the same amount of fuel, so he used to have another lap. But yeah, we are doing pretty much the same thing and pretty much the same pace, so it's all down to the margins, and this time it was on my side, so it's great.
Alright, well, moving us a small step down the ladder here, we'll just find Casper Hogall in the picture. There we are. Casper, as we mentioned just before, the other way around, you seem to throw away a victory here at Sepang, actually. What happened, man? I didn't see it.
Yeah, actually I'm very upset about this, because I really felt like this was a very good race, and last time at Suzuka I think Chris was the faster car, but this time I really felt that I had the faster car and were going the fastest. But yeah, the change at the end, I had the lead on about 2 or 3 seconds until we met up with Ben Juul, and I had a lot of trouble getting past him. And actually it was almost crashed, but then that Chris caught up, and I couldn't just drive it home safe as planned. Everything up to that point went as planned and very good, and all my pit strategies worked, and that's just very unfortunate.
Another thing I was wondering during the race was the pit stops of the Lamborghinis. Were you indeed bringing full tanks of petrol, or were you was bringing something along the lines of 80 or 90 liters and then changing the tires both times, is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. I brought 77 liters of fuel, and it's, yeah, it went as always, like you said. I use a little less fuel than Chris, I don't know why, but it just works out. And And then I had two very, very nice and fast pit stops. So I gained some time on Chris there, and that's actually what I lost in the end.
All right. Well, we'll take another little jump down the list here, down to Peter Moncon. And Peter, a new car for you, and another kind of race, clearly, but... you ended up all by yourself, actually, with the margins of almost a minute, both up to second position and down to fourth position.
Yeah, out with the old shopping cart, in with a sports car. Yeah, but I just proved to be too much of a handful to drive to compete for top spaces, and what actually happened in every race was that I was faster than the guys that I was driving against on stability, but not on car performance. And so I analyzed the last three races, and looked at what happened and why I crashed out and actually why things went so wrong, and I came to the conclusion that I was much more stable than the guys driving around me, and every time I caught up with them on my stability, they started fighting me, and they obviously didn't have the car control to handle that, so I got bumped a lot of times and the car got damaged. So it seemed more logical, since I wanted more excitement and I wanted to drive with the guys in front, to change to another car and just give a damn about the point standings, because I was never going to win that anyway. So I thought I'd switch out to something fun and then try to race, and lo and behold, it turned out to be the most frustrating race I've had all season. In the beginning I thought, this is going to turn out great, but then what I thought was excellent weather for the Corvette, since it was colder, turned out to be actually a step to the worse, because the car eats up the front tires. I don't know what it is about this track, but it seems that front engine cars will eat up the front tires because they don't have the weight in the back, and the front tires are narrower than the rear tires, so carrying 50% of the weight on the front tires and using those at the same time to brake extremely hard down to all the hairpins on the track seems to just wear out the tires. So in the end, there was nothing to do, and actually the car was just about half to a whole second slower than it was in the practice sessions, where we had about 35 degrees on the track. Then what happened was, yet again, when I was turning up or catching up on Sten Stenik, he then pulled another one of his maneuvers. He must be born in the constellation "I'll fuck your race up." The car got bent very, very roughly. It lost about 2 seconds on the pace on a lap. I was suddenly doing lap times over 2 minutes, so I knew I had to pit and take a look at to fix the aero damage to be fast enough to catch up with the guys and keep my position on the third position in the race.
Yeah, and it seemed like you pitted in a bit prematurely, actually, and you had to take a lot more fuel on board than you'd planned.
Yeah, that caused me to have to take on hard front tires and hard rear tires, and of course that would just create even more understeer, but then a more stable understeer through the stint, so that was just a little plus. But fixed the aero damage, but retained the, I think it was 105 seconds to repair suspension damage. So that was kind of a bugger to drive around with, but the top speed was there, and I was able to keep a reasonably good pace and keep the guys behind me. But in the end, boring and frustrating race again, even though I changed the car to fight exactly that. But I guess that's just how it is.
Yeah, that's racing, mate, I think. Anyway, we have three more guys to talk with here, and the next two pair of guys is Gerd Nielsen and Ben Juul. Ben Juul doesn't seem to be here, but Gerd Nielsen, you are. And you were actually the pair of racers that were the closest in the race, next to Chris Dons and Kasper Hougaard. You were racing with a gap of 7-8 seconds between you for almost an hour straight on.
Yeah, it was a very exciting race for me. In the two first stint, there was a very close racing. Then there was Ben Juul has some little accident with Nikolai, I think, and then he dropped back. So at the end of the race, I think I was about 20 seconds before him or so. But, a very nice race for me, and I'm very happy to be number four.
Yeah, and it seemed a very stable performance from you guys, actually, compared to what we've, excuse me to say, what we've seen earlier.
Yeah, thank you. And but compared to the aliens, three aliens up front, we are slow, but down there, it's a very nice race, I think.
Yeah, and it has been some nice racing to watch, even though it hasn't been for the top position, so I must admit. Bringing me to the last guy in the field, and probably also the most interesting guy is Jan Malbec and your Celine and your little experiment there. Jan, you were actually the only guy in the entire field who managed to single stop this race. Tell me how that all played out.
Well, first of all, my race was pretty slow, actually. I must admit that I didn't put in the practice time for this race, so I knew I didn't have the car or the speed to match the ones around me. So I tried to do it on economy instead of speed. But unfortunately, I had a little accident with Geert at the first corner of the race, where he hit me in the rear. And I had suspension damage, which I didn't fix, so the entire race I drove around with suspension damage, which cost me, I think, half a second lap. So I didn't have a fast car, but I tried to do it on economy, but it didn't work. So, yeah.
It's a shame, really, because it turned out to be a very interesting experiment, actually, and I did some calculations along the way, and it did win you at least a minute on Ben Jewell, actually, and it could have been more if you hadn't had small incidents, but quite an achievement being the only guy who was able to single stop this race. I was actually thinking that the Covette would have been able to do the same thing, and Steen Stenige, impressively, he would have gotten that Lamborghini to do it as well. He was well under the 1 hour mark before he pitted in, and then all the entire farce with him braking and reversing and I don't know what not happened, and of course he didn't finish the race.
Yeah, I think that he would have had a great position if he had pitted at the right time and took on some fuel. But my race, I don't know, because of the suspension damage, my front tires were gone after 4 or 5 laps. So actually, I rode around the last 4 laps of each stint. I had tire warning, so I had massive understeer.
Ooh, that's impressive, actually, because I was discussing that early on, actually, and it's classically it's the rear tires with the Celine that's the problem.
Well, I didn't really achieve a good balance in the car. It was understeer from the start, and then I don't know, the suspension damage made it even worse. And I also had some funny snap oversteers all of a sudden. That's where I spun. Sometimes it would just lose the rear. I don't know why.
All right. Well, that's that done. We have 2 more races remaining in this series, if I remember correctly. The next race is, of course, in 2 weeks as usual. That's going to be 2 hours of the Melbourne circuit in Canada. And
Australia.
The Melbourne. The Melbourne circuit. Oh, yeah, I keep
Melbourne, Australia.
I keep toiling that up with the Canadian Grand Prix. Anyway. 2 hours of Melbourne, it's set in 2 weeks, so that's going to be the 11th of March, Sunday as usual, and
the Canadian Grand Prix is Montreal, so Montreal
and Melbourne, that's right, that's what happened there. So that's what we're going to drive next, and then of course in 4 weeks we're going to have our very grand finale on Spa-Francorchamps, and that's going to be a 3 hour race.
Yay!
So that's that for now, that's that for the Sepang circuit, and we are going from Malaysia a little jump to the south down to Australia next week, and we hope to see you there.